y'all did.
Good morning, Peerless Road Church. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Those who come on in, come on in, that are in the atrium, come on in. Those of you that are watching online, we are so excited to have you here today. We are so excited to, and privileged to have our Cleveland Mayor, Mayor Kelvin Brooks. Would you give him a warm PRC welcome? We'll do that again. We are so excited that you're here today, here to join us. And as we get ready, would you go ahead and stand with me as we get ready, of course, and a lot of things taking place today, a full day, a full week, full month, as we get ready to come. Of course, we know as we turn our attention, of course, we have a lot of people in the city of Cleveland, that, of course, that are sick right now, many that have already called, and we want to come together. We reminded you last week, we want to be encouraged because we have the power of prayer. You believe that? We have the power to call upon the name of Jesus. And right already in the first service, such a powerful presence of the Holy Spirit. And we're just going to believe that he's going to manifest himself in hospital rooms, in bedrooms, and in places where people are at right now. Do you believe that? Let's call on God and ask him to do that. Father, Lord, you see. Lord, you're omnipresent. Father, God, you're everywhere. You're all-knowing. You're omniscient. And Father, God, as we come right now to the name and call upon the name of Jesus, Lord, you see your sons and daughters, Lord, in the places where they're at. Father God, I'm so encouraged, Lord, by the word of God, Lord, that Hagar called you. You're the God who sees. Father, we thank you that you see us, Lord, in our lowest point. You see us on our highest point. But Father, we just pray right now. I'm asking you, Lord, as a corporate body, we are coming together. Lord, we're doing exactly what the word says in Galatians. We're bearing one another's burdens. We bring our brothers and our sisters to you right now. Father, we're asking you, Lord, that you would just begin to give them strength in their bodies. Father, that you would let the blood of Jesus not only, Lord, just be available, but Lord, would you apply it, Lord, as you did the blood, the doorposts of the children of Israel's homes, Father. We ask you right now, would you apply the blood of Jesus? Church, would you just pray with me right now? I believe we're just, Lord, say, I hear the whole Lord saying, pray, and I will answer right now. So, Father, we come together. We come together with belief and faith for our brothers and sisters right now. There are many that are sick. We may not even know the names, but Father, we have brothers and sisters in Christ, Father, who need the encouragement. And Lord, we believe that the blood of Jesus is all powerful. There is nothing. There's no virus. There's no cancer. There's nothing that can come against, no disease that has ever been labeled, Father, that is greater than the name and the blood which was shed on Mount Calvary. So, Father, we ask you, would you hear, Lord, the prayers of your children? And would you let the earthquakes happen, Lord, as we were recorded in Revelation, Lord, because it was the prayers of the saints that were filling the bowls, and earthquakes and fires took place. Father, would you let our bodies begin to shake, Father, under the power of the response of prayers of coming from your sons and daughters. Father, we're here, Lord, to worship you, but we're here to pray, and we're here, God, to see you move. Father, would we hear testimonies of your power that is taking place in people's lives right now in the name of Jesus. Are you ready to encounter God? Amen. Let's worship together as we get ready to be encouraged.
Amen. Who believes he's worthy this morning? Worthy of praise, we will shout and proclaim the greatness of your holy name. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, and worthy of praise. Lift it up this morning. You are holy. You are holy. Yes. The whole earth sings your praise. whole earth sings your praise. You are holy. You are holy, so holy. The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. Goodness, we will sing alleluia to the King. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, you're worthy of praise. I'm now redeemed, I'm now redeemed from my past. Your people dance because we're free at last. You're worthy of glory, worthy of honor, worthy of praise. Sing, He's holy. You are holy. You are holy. The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. You are holy. You are holy.
So holy.
The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise.
We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. We pour. Let's do that this morning. Yes.
We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you. We pour out our best for you.
Lift it up, church.
We pour out our best for you. 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 We pour out our best for you.
You are holy.
You are holy. The whole earth sings your praise. The whole earth sings your praise. You are holy. The whole earth sings your praise. We pour out our best for you. 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 We pour out our best for you.
Come on, church, look it up this morning.
We pour out our best for you. 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 We pour out our best for you.
Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Cause Jesus, you're the center. Everything revolves around you, Jesus.
Sing Jesus.
Jesus, be the center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be. It's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Cause Jesus, you're the center. Jesus. Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all.
Let's keep
about
repeating
you.
That this morning.
Yes, it's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
From my heart
to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
From my heart
to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you.
It's all about him this morning. It's all about him every day. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful? All the world can come to him to have their sins removed. Isn't the name of Jesus wonderful?
Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Son of God and one of us, lover of our souls. Isn't the name of Jesus beautiful? Eternal King,
eternal King, you will reign forever, and we will see the glory of your name. Be lifted high for all the world to see that your name is all we need. Your name is all we need. Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Isn't the name of Jesus powerful? Chains are broken when it's spoken. Every knee must bow. Isn't the name of Jesus powerful?
We sing eternal.
Eternal King. Salvation in the name. There is life in the name. There is no other name but Jesus. Jesus.
There is freedom.
There is freedom in the name. Healing in the name. There is power in the name. Salvation in the name, and there is life in the name. There is no other name but Jesus.
salvation in the name.
And there is life in the name. There is no other name but Jesus. Isn't the name of Jesus all we need? Isn't the name of Jesus all we need? He's the way, the truth, the life, the only way to God. Isn't the name of Jesus all we need? And turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Turn your eyes.
First resurrection morning, that there was such devastation in the life of Mary Magdalene when she went to the tomb and it was empty. In fact, Jesus shows up in that most devastating moment and he calls her by name and she says, if you'll just tell me where you've taken him. Because all she could see was the news of the empty tomb. But rather, in that moment, he called out her name, Mary, and she turned and she yells out the words, Rabboni, which means teacher. In that moment, she had to literally take her eyes off of the present circumstance, the present situation that she was fully invested in that moment. Can I tell you this morning, through the Word of God and through worship, our Savior, Jesus Christ, is calling our personal name right now in this moment. There are many that are sick among us. There are many that are not here this morning and they're sick. We got calls this morning already sick. We have families that are hurting, those that are watching online. But I want to tell you, if we can do exactly what this song says, if we can turn our eyes from our present circumstance and our present pain and our present lack of being able to breathe, can I tell you, Jesus wants to do a miracle in that moment. He wants to show himself. He wants to show up. You know what he did in that moment? He showed up personally. He showed up powerfully as the Savior of the world. And right now, in this moment, can we just turn our eyes? Can we just turn our attention away from whatever distraction the enemy may be bringing into your life? Those of you that are watching online, because I believe this and I know this, that as we call upon the name of Jesus, our praise, and I said in the first service, will attract His personal presence. So right there, would you give Him your personal praise? Father, we come before You right now. Father, we can even be honest with You and tell You, this is what I'm facing. This is what is attacking my mind right now. But Father, I hear You calling my name in worship. I hear you calling my name as you did Mary. And Lord, would you cause me to do what happened to her? She turned from the present and saw the eternal. Father, would we turn our eyes from the present circumstances and, Lord, look into the author, the finisher of our faith, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. Lord, the one who orchestrates our steps. Father, we clearly identify we need you in this moment. We need you in this hour. We need you to show up. So we call upon the name of Jesus. Would you say that name with me?
Jesus.
Now, when we just say it, it's a name. But when we proclaim it, it's power. It's power. It's power. There's healing in the name of Jesus. There's power in the name of Jesus. Those of you that are online that are sick right now, there's healing when you call upon the name of Jesus. We can't bring you to the front of the church, what James tells us, to bring you the elders. But what you can do is you can pray for yourself, and the omnipresent King right now will show up. Can we just call upon the name of Jesus right now? Say it, Jesus. Move right now, Jesus. Heal right now, Jesus. Do what only you can do, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give the Lord a hand clap of praise in his house this morning. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of God. Course, we're going to continue to take up the offerings, and I want to take just a few moments as we get ready. We're going to have a special in just a moment, but I want to say a special thank you. We had a lightning strike our building last Sunday evening, and it's knocked out our soundboard and many different, a plethora of things that help Sunday morning run effectively. And so our IT team, many of the young men and women on this stage have worked tirelessly, even into the wee hours of this morning, to make sure that it was working, because you don't know it's working until you use it, and you don't know what, if it's dead until you can't use it. And so I want to say a special thank you to all of those. I was on a plane in Memphis and on Wednesday night and said, soundboard's dead. I was like, oh no. You know, and there's nothing I can do about it. And so I stand on the shoulders of great young men and women, and I want to say thank you to them as much as well. Thank you for being here today, of course. We have our volunteer luncheon will be taking place after that. And if you are desiring to volunteer, if you volunteer, if you want to volunteer, we have a mandated mandatory child and youth and worker protection policy that we go through every 2 years. I know many have already called, Pastor, I can't be there. How can we do it? We're going to try to work that out at a different date. But if you're here, there's a free lunch. If you want to volunteer, I remember being at Lee, one of the greatest things they could get us to do is offer free food. We show up. And so free food. Of course, and to our young adults who are here, we'll offer you free food next week as well, right after church. There'll be a young adult luncheon. And so you can go on the website and sign up for that and make sure that we know that you're coming. Of course, and we want to say thank you for your patience, as we know our atrium bathrooms have been down. And when we tore off the sheetrock, we encountered some damage that we didn't anticipate when our atrium flooded a few years ago in the extreme weather. And so we are tirelessly working towards that. I want to say thank you to Michael, Nix, and others who are working on that. And so we want to just say thank you for your patience. Of course, I'm going to give you an opportunity. How many of you love opportunities? That's what life is made of, right? Of course, and so the opportunity is to help us to repair our bathrooms by giving in the building fund today. And so you can give in the black boxes as you get ready to give, of course, and it'll help us to make sure not only that we update, but we also fix everything that needs to get done. But we are so privileged to have you here today, and we're so glad that you're here with us. There's many different things that are taking place in the website. Make sure that you look on there to see all this going on. But let us, as the worship team gets ready, as Angie is getting ready to lead us, I want you to turn your attention to the Word of God. Turn your attention to what the Holy Spirit is speaking to us. We've been talking about encouragement all week, and I believe as they lead us in worship in the song, as we get ready for the Word, would you turn your eyes upon Jesus and let Him personally speak to us this morning.
You know my name.
And oh, how he talks with me. And oh, how he tells me that I am his own. As you
you. victory, cause your power is within me. No giant can defeat me.
Give the Lord a hand clap of praise if you believe that. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Do you believe He knows your name?
Yes.
Come on.
Yes.
I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of things going on right now, but what I feel the Holy Spirit is trying to get us to do is we're not going to lay down on this thing. We're not going to lay back. I know the things are rising. It feels like the waters are rising. But I'm going to tell you, a lot of times we say, well, the enemy comes in like a flood. No, I'm going to change that for just a minute. When the enemy comes in like a flood, the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. We've had flooding in Tennessee this last night. But I'm going to tell you, when the enemy's trying to come in, encouragement can come in. The Spirit of the living God can fill the upper rooms and the crevices of your life. I feel like the Holy Spirit is looking at us and saying, I need the people to rise up in faith. I need the people to speak up in faith. Who believe in if they still believe in the power of my resurrection, if they still believe and there's power in the blood of Jesus, I don't need you to sit down. I need you to stand up. I don't need you to be silent. I need you to speak up. I don't need you to go hide out. I need you to shine out and let the power of the blood of Jesus and the power of the name, if you haven't realized it in this worship, He's been trying to get us to call upon the name of Jesus. Why? Because no giant shall stand against me. The power of the blood of Jesus, the power that raised Christ from the dead. Church, can I tell you, it's within us. The power of life is in us. It's not for us to stay defeated. I'm not trying to stir, I'm not trying to tell you that we've got to wake up, climb out of your coffins, the message says in the book of Ephesians. Some of us have already put ourselves down. You've put your dreams to bed. You've put your dreams and everything, all your retirement stuff that's happening in your life, you're putting it down as if we have forgotten that God still is sitting on the throne. Church, He's not shaking right now. He's got Christians in Afghanistan that are not scared of the Taliban coming in, but you know what they're saying? We are not afraid because Jesus is with us, and here we are in the comforts of our freedom, and we're willing to stay seated and willing to stay quiet and willing to be quiet and keep our faith quiet. No, praise God, we have the freedoms that we have. So let us not take them for granted, but let us have an opportunity when the opportunity presents itself. Let us lift up the name of Jesus. Let us lift up a praise that is worthy to Him in the middle of our problems and struggles. Hallelujah. So can we sing that just one more, that chorus one more time? But would you stand with me across? I know I'm not trying, but I'm going to tell you, we've got to be reminded of the power. Some of you are in situations. Some of you online are in situations right now, and it feels like the giant is right in front of you. It feels like the pressure in your chest is never going to get out. But I'm going to tell you, when there is power in the name of Jesus, let's act like it. Let's remember it and act like it. It's the power of God that saved us. It's the power of God that sustains us and frees us. Let's give Him the praise. Let's give Him the breath that He's already given to us as a gift. Let's turn around and give it back to Him. Just one more time. Go ahead.
No mountain can stop me, 'cause You hold my hand.
praise that he's worthy of. Hallelujah. Give him a praise he's worthy of in his house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. You may be seated. Again, we are privileged to have Mayor Kevin Brooks here with us, the bishop in the Church of God, but also our mayor in the City of Spirit. And we are so privileged that we have an anointed man of God. Of course, I'm thankful that the steps of our city has been orchestrated, that before this ever happened, he put a man of God and a man of faith and a man of the Spirit in the office to see us through this tumultuous time. And so we are privileged to have you with it. We'll hear from him in just a few moments. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 30. 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses 1 through 6. And of course, I'm going to tell you a real quick story, because there's this little boy, and I've got my Louisville Slugger here, but anyway, I'm not going to say it. But anyway, this small little boy, he went into his backyard, as like every single boy does, especially in the little league, and they're playing, and he throws up the ball, and he throws it up, and as he's throwing up the ball, he's getting ready to swing, and he says, "I am the greatest hitter in all the world." And as he goes to swing the bat, the ball drops to the ground, and he misses it. Well, then he picks up the ball and he throws it back up in the air and he goes for another swing and he says, "I'm the greatest hitter in all the world." And as he swings, he misses it again. But he picks up the ball a third time and he says, and he throws the ball again up in the air and says, "I'm the greatest hitter in all the world." And you know what? He swings and he misses it a third time. By that time, he lays the bat down. He picks up the bat ball and says, "I am the greatest pitcher in all the world." You see, because one of what that young man identified is what you and I need to identify, is that we need to encourage ourselves despite the circumstance that we find ourselves in. You see, the news is that there's a difference in the news and the truth. The news is what is happening in our lives right now. The news is what is taking place in many of our families and bodies and community in the nation right now. But the truth is that God is in the happening of your life. God is in the middle of your circumstance. The truth is that we can stand on the word of God. The truth is what God has spoken. In 1 Samuel chapter 30, verses 1 through 6, we're going to stay here today. I'm going to read several scriptures in different places. You can follow along with me on the screen, or you can look in the Bible app as well under the events section is there and follow along. And we're not going to hold you long, and we've got the dinner that's waiting for you as well. But it says, "And it came to pass that when David and his men were coming to Ziklag on the third day, that the Amalekites had invaded the south, and Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire, and had taken the women captives that were therein. They slew not any, either great or small, but carried them away and went on their way. So David and his men came to the city, and behold, it was burned with fire, and their wives and their sons and their daughters were taken captives. Then David and the people that were with him lifted up their voice and wept until they had no more power to weep. And David's two wives were taken captives, Ahinoam the Jezreelitess and Abigail, the wife of Nabal the Carmelite. And David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people were grieved, every man for his sons and for his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God." When we look at this, when we go back to the very first scripture, because today we want to talk about encouraging ourselves. We've been talking about encouragement the last couple of weeks. And as I was beginning to look at this passage of the scripture, and I'll use the King James this morning, because in verse 1, we oftentimes will read it, especially in King James, but then all of a sudden the Spirit began to, as I was preparing, wanted me to just remind some of you. In verse 1 it says, "And it came to pass, then when David and his men were come to Ziklag on the third day, the Amalekites had invaded the south and Ziklag and smitten Ziklag and burned it with fire." But the first five words right there are what the Lord wants me to remind you of this morning. The first point is that circumstances don't come to stay, they come to pass. Some of you this morning need to gather that, and that's the encouragement of how you can encourage yourself this morning, because you're in the middle of circumstances and situations right now that are beyond your control. You have no idea what's going to happen. Some of you are parents and your kids are in school, and some of you are students in school, and you're trying to figure out, how am I going to navigate this situation? But I want you to understand something, that what we're going through right now is temporary and pales in comparison to eternity. The situation that we're going through right now, circumstances and situations don't come to stay, they come to pass. In the same way that it come to pass that David and Ziklag, there's a situation, I want you to understand, those of you that are watching online right now because you can't physically be with us, I want you to know that this is not the end. Those of you that are going through situations right now, this is not the end. Don't own the pain. Don't own the circumstances. Don't own the guilt. Don't own the shame that may come with choices that you have made. Borrow them, because our Savior points it and identifies us. In Luke, the Bible tells us that when Jesus was taken down off of the cross, that he was laid in a borrowed tomb. It was Joseph of Arimathea's tomb. It was not Jesus's. He says, I just need to borrow it because I don't own it. I'm going to rise again. And some of us need to understand the situation and the circumstances that we're going through, they're coming to pass. The coronavirus, I want to encourage you, it's going to pass. I don't know when, I don't know how, but I'll promise you one day it's not going to matter, because the King of Glory is going to show up. And when he shows up, he's going to consume everything that goes against him. This is going to pass. The valley that you feel that you're in, it's going to pass, but so is the mountaintops. Don't get stuck where we're at. Don't get stuck in the highs and the lows of life, because what I know about God is that he wants our complete dependence on him. But notice what happens and when everyone is absent in your life. The second point, we want to talk about encouraging yourself, because what happened in this story is that David and his mighty men, these were mighty warriors, okay? Especially to our students, that some of the things that you're going through, it's going to pass. But I'm going to tell you, as David found himself with his mighty men, he found himself in the middle of a battle, and he was coming in, and on that day, he saw the smoke off in the distance. And when he got closer to the city, he didn't hear the shrills of kids playing out in the streets. He didn't hear the sounds of the mighty men coming in for battle, did not hear the sounds of wives coming out and coming to greet them at the city gates. No, that wasn't taking place. It was silent. It was eerily silent. Some of you know what that silence sounds like. Some of you have been in doctor's rooms and it was just a routine appointment, but the doctor comes in and says, I need to tell you something, and no one else is in the room with you, you think. Some of you have been left in situations and circumstances. Some of you in marriages and relationships. Some of you and parents have walked out of your life. Maybe they've never been there. And there's always that eerie silence of a voice that's not heard. But I'm going to tell you something. We can encourage ourselves regardless of the situation this morning, regardless of the situation that you're going to come into, is that God is present with us. When the kids leave and there's an empty nest, I'm going to tell you something. It may feel empty, but we're always present. There's always God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You're never alone, although it may feel that way. You see, the story is that David comes in, and all of a sudden, everybody is standing with David, his mighty men who fought with him in mighty battles in different situations. Even they're walking away from David. Because what had happened, I'm going to tell you something, is that when you want to be the one to call the shots, sometimes you're going to have to take the shots. Our mayor can attest to that, he knows, but especially in any kind of leadership, you understand that if you're going to be the one who's calling the shots, if you want to be the one who's calling what's happening, you know, this is one of, if you want to talk about encouraging, pastors are having to encourage themselves more than they've ever had to. Nowadays, especially since last year. I mean, do you know that there are people that used to sit among us that are not sitting among us now because we had to require masks when we were coming back? I mean, the polarization of what the enemy is trying to do. We are mighty men of God standing with men and women of God, but the enemy is trying to get us to isolate ourselves and pull away. But I'm going to tell you something. But in that moment that David, he's the one that said, hey, let's go over here, and he called the shots, and now the mighty men, the mighty warriors that were once standing beside him in the thick and thin, they've even gone absent. Now they're not there. And all of a sudden, David is finding himself all alone. But do you know that there's 42 verses about God's presence being everywhere? David writes in Psalms 139, he says, where shall I go from your spirit? Or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, you're there. He says, he's trying to keep us to realize is that, God, I cannot get away from your presence. Can I tell you, I know that by the love of God and the power of God and the presence of God, is he's able to meet you in your darkest hour. He can walk through a drunken slumber. He can walk through an overdose. He can walk through situations that we find ourselves at the lowest point, because I'm going to tell you something, what I can't do, my God can do. And when you pray and when you believe that God can show up, when you pray for your prodigals and they're in the hog pen of life and they feel all alone, can I tell you that the presence of God can meet them and let them know, I am with you and I can rescue you in that moment. So take hope, take heart that we've got a God who is with us and with those who we pray for. In Deuteronomy 31 and 8, it says that the Lord who goes before you, he will be with you. He will not leave you or forsake you. Do not fear and do not be dismayed. We sang it in Luke 10 and 20. Here come the disciples, and they're eagerly running to Jesus, and they come to Jesus, and they say, hey, we know how to cast out the demons. They listen. They obey us. And Jesus looks at them in Luke 10 and 20. He says, listen, rejoice not. Do not rejoice in this, that the spirits are subject to you. He says, but rejoice. Take hope. Take joy that your name is written down in heaven. You can cast out demons, but you're forgetting about it. There's something a whole lot more important about life. Encourage yourself that your name is written in the Lamb's book of life. We can encourage ourselves that God sees us. He knows our name. He sees you. In Genesis 16 and 13, she gave Hagar, that young teenage girl who was in the middle of a dry wilderness and in the desert, she gave him this name to the Lord who spoke to her. He speaks to us. You are the God who sees me. For she said, I have now seen the one who sees me. We go back and we saw it in 31 and 8 of Deuteronomy. But in Hebrews 13 and 5, we are reminded by the unknown author, keep your life free from love of money and be content with what you have. For as he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. What I'm trying to encourage you with this morning is that you've got to look in the mirror of your life and you've got to begin to encourage yourself that no matter who walks in or out of my life, I have a God who sees me. I have a God who holds me in the palm of his hands. The one who crafted the oceans in the palm of his hand is the one who sees you. He calls you. He speaks to you. Thirdly, I want to just give you some practical ways. If you find yourself in a situation like David did, where everyone has abandoned you and you feel like, I can't get a hold of the pastor, I can't get a prayer on the one call, I can't get a prayer call out, who is praying for me? Can I tell you, we have a Savior who right now who is praying for you. We have a Holy Spirit who's making intercession for us. We are never alone, so we can encourage ourselves. In the darkest moments of our life, the light of the world is going to show up. Hallelujah. But you can encourage yourself in your relationship with God. Verse 6, and David was greatly distressed, for the people spake of stoning him, because the soul of all the people was grieved, every man for his sons and his daughters. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. Can I tell you, those of us that have a relationship with Jesus Christ, and if you're here in person or you're watching online, you can have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. It's not just a prayer that gets you out of hell. You can have a personal relationship with God. Y'all can talk to one another. He can encourage you. He can empower you. He can sustain you, because David encouraged himself in the Lord his God, not in the Lord God of his mighty men. But David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. In the book of Psalms, you see a lot of times where he's looking and he's saying, my God, my God. Can I tell you, there's going to come a point in time in your life, and every single person I'm amazed by, that mama's faith is going to fade away. And we're going to be placed in situations where we can't get a hold of the pastor, and we can't get a hold of mom and daddy, and we can't get a hold of granny and grandpa, but we're going to have to face it on our own. But it's in that moment that God is going to show up, and he's going to speak up, and he's going to show up in power, and he's going to speak up in power, and he's trying to get you to realize that the earth will pass away, but my strength is in power. My strength is eternal, and you can call on my name, and I will be an ever-present help in a time of trouble. That's who our God is. So we can encourage ourselves that we have a personal relationship with God. Sometimes we can look at other people and say, oh, they're mighty men of the faith. But can I tell you, God wants to make you go greater than those men and women that you see. God wants to have such a deep relationship with you that you go greater than what you see in yourself. We can encourage ourselves with our own words. We can speak life. In Joel chapter 3, verses 10, notice what Joel is saying to the people. He says, beat your plowshares into swords and your pruning hooks and the spears, getting ready to go into battle. He says, but let the weak say, I am strong. There is life and death in the power of the tongue. He says, the reason you can encourage yourself in the power of Scripture. Don't just read this, begin to memorize it. David hid thy word in his heart that he might not sin against thee. Why? Because he realized that he had to encourage himself. I don't have to give in to this temptation. I don't have to fall like the world. I don't have to give in, because greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. When you can encourage yourself right out of a temptation by speaking life and speaking the word of God in that moment. In Philippians 4:13, I can do all things. Finish it with me. Who strengthens me? Daniel 11:32, he says, he shall seduce with flattery those who violate the covenant, but the people who know their God shall stand firm and take action. The people who know their God shall stand firm and take action. We can encourage ourselves through prayers. We can encourage ourselves through the prayers that we pray. You have a prayer life. Do you use it? Because as we talk about encouraging ourselves, do you know one of the greatest weapons that you have is your prayer life? Is beginning to pray the supplications of your prayers. I mean, coming boldly before the throne of grace that we may obtain mercy. As the author of Hebrews told us, our prayer life is powerful. We can encourage ourselves through prayer. Notice what happens in Mark chapter 14, verses 26. In that moment, we encourage our worship. But let me go back. Psalms 42 and 5. The psalmist is writing here. He says, why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you in turmoil with me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my salvation. Your prayers have the ability to encourage yourself. If you begin to pray and say, God, I don't understand why I'm going through this. But if your prayer life will turn into the scriptures, start. If you don't know how to pray, pray the scriptures. If you don't know what to say, pray the scriptures. Pray them and say, and this is sometimes how I would remember. I said, God, I'm going to remind you what you said. I'm going to remind you what you told Moses. I'm going to remind you what you told David. I'm going to remind you what you told your disciples. God, I'm going to remind you of your word. And if you spoke it, you don't lie, and you're never going to lie. So I need you to show up in this like you did here in my life. But we also can encourage ourselves through worship. In Mark 14 through 26, when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus was about to go through one of the darkest moments of his life. And right after they take the communion, the Lord's communion, which is the juice and the bread, you know what they did? They sang the hymn. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I don't think they were singing Amazing Grace. And sometimes, I'm going to tell you something about the power of our worship. Sometimes we can sit here and worship. You know, it's amazing to me that the one thing that Satan was in charge of is the one thing that separates churches. Worship. He was the worship leader. But the Bible says, but I'm going to talk to you about worship, and we're not going down that worship because I want to talk to you about encouraging yourself. But some of you get encouraged through different songs. Some of us have grown up in different genres. Some of us identify that I remember the day when I was singing this song and this changed my life. I remember this song and it helped me through. I remember as a teenager singing, I'm going into the enemy's camp, taking back what he stole from me. Remember that? And I remember how that used to, and some of those things I remember as a child. It's not the matter of the song that you're singing. It's the fact that you're beginning to encourage yourself with the worship that you're in. I don't know what song they sung. I don't know if they pulled out a psalm and began to sing that, but the important thing is that before Jesus Christ went to face the battle of the cross, before he was betrayed, he saw that it was important enough to encourage himself in worship. I'm going to tell you something. As we sit here today, I'm so thankful that Mayor Brooks will be ready, because I want to invite him to the stage, because I was sitting in the Memphis airport this week and preparing this message, and all of a sudden I said, Lord, there's something about worship and encouraging ourselves. And if you'll join me on the stage, Bishop, because Mayor Bishop, what do we call you? Reverend?
Brother Mayor.
And all of a sudden, I left from Memphis, went to that funeral all the way to St. Mary's, and I called him. I said, Mayor, I just need to ask you, what was that song? I've heard your testimony. Can you tell me your testimony? And then as I began to say, that testimony is powerful, he said, I'm willing to come. Mayor, we are privileged to have you. Can we give him a warm Peerless Road Church welcome?
Thank you, Pastor. I thank you for the invitation to again share a testimony. Thank you to the praise team for the worship, because you blessed me and you brought us all into the throne room of God. And that is how my healing testimony ended. But it began, Pastor, just like David at Ziklag, that 1 Samuel chapter 30, verse 6. Did you notice that verse?
Yeah.
David stressed, and 24 words later, he was encouraging himself.
Right.
I was distressed in the hospital. It's still very emotional for me. We've lost 159 Clevelanders. We're in a battle. But the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are worship. And just like David at Ziklag, I had gone through all of those emotions. I had begun thanking God for the doctors and the nurses and the medical attention. But I was hospitalized at Tenova for 11 days, six of those in ICU. I should not be here today. The doctors and the nurses tell me you received a miracle. And I thank God for that. Amen. But during that time of difficulty and distress, I began to question, God, where are you? Those questions turned to anger. Because 50% of COVID is physical. You are sicker than you have ever been. Brother Taylor shared with me, his wife was unable to call into the next room. I know exactly how that is. My wife said there were 26 hours where they didn't hear from me. I physically did not have the strength to speak. But on the ninth day, in one of those arguments with God, why, oh God, have you forsaken me? God very clearly spoke into my spirit. And he said, if you will give me the sacrifice of praise, like Paul singing in prison, I will heal you. And I was in prison. You're in ICU. You're in an airlock chamber where they have to hesitate to come in because of the air pressure in the doors. It was like prison. No one could come see me and I couldn't go out. And I remember questioning God, God, I can barely breathe. I was on oxygen 24 hours a day. That was the ninth day. It was as high as they could turn the oxygen. The next step was the ventilator. And I said, God, I can hardly breathe. And you want me to sing? And he said, yes. And I'm not a born singer, much less with COVID. And I felt in my spirit immediately the words of a song that is not a familiar song to me. It's not like the song, Turn Your Eyes Upon Jesus, that I grew up, my grandmother singing to me. But I felt very clear in my spirit that I'm supposed to sing and praise God. And the words very clearly came to me, it's your breath in my lungs. So I pour out my praise. I pour out my praise. And in the worst sick voice you've ever heard, cracking and breaking and crying because it hurt, I began to sing, it's your breath in my lungs. So I pour out my praise. And God heard those prayers of all of you that prayed for me, people that stood outside the window and held their arms towards my ICU room. I thank God for every one of you because God heard your prayers and he heard my praise. And together he performed a miracle because I sung it a third time. I sung it a fourth time and the beeping behind me became so fierce, I actually thought something was wrong. And I turned around and took a picture. I should have sent it to you, Nick, so you could have shown it on the screen. I've got a picture of my breathing, which was in the 90s for the first time in 9 days. An instantaneous, miraculous healing. To God be the glory. And I say that because it was not easy. I was distressed. But I took hold of that promise of God and encouraged myself in the Lord that with the sacrifice of praise, in 2 days, they took me from a wheelchair from ICU to the front door. There was no step-down room because they said, you don't need one. You have been healed. Amen. Pastor, thank you for letting me come by and share my testimony. I love you.
Love you too.
I love this church. Thank you for praying for our city.
No, thank you.
Amen.
Mayor Brooks has got he's got to get to his church for an engagement that's taking place. And so let's let him know how much we appreciate him being here with us today again. And can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise? Sitting in that airport, and I called him, and I said, I was trying to think, Mayor, but when I think about the power of worship, I said, I remember you literally being at the edge of life and death and you singing a song. And can I tell you that there is a song on the inside of you that has the power to break the back of the enemy? Do you hear what I'm saying this morning? I'm not a natural singer. I love to sing solos. You know it. Solo, you can't hear me. All right. But I'm going to tell you something. There is a song on the inside of you that has the power to break the enemy's voice off of your ears. Some of you have been so enamored by the attacks of the enemy and the distractive thoughts of the enemy that this is never going to pass, that this is going to be permanent, that I've got your children in the palm of my hands. Some of you are going through situations that are just like David, and you feel entrenched and you feel alone and you feel abandoned. Some of you are traveling miles after miles trying to get to your children and there's nobody with you. Some of you, said it a while ago, you feel like you can't get a hold of me. You feel like you can't get a hold of anybody, but I'm going to tell you that there is a song on the inside of your life that only you know the words to it, because it's the song of the redeemed. It's the song of how God redeemed you. If he's ever healed you, it's the song of how God has healed you before and he'll do it again. Some of you need to recognize that there is a song inside of you, and if you, the only way that you've prayed and it seems like God isn't answering, Pastor tells me to read the Bible, and some of you are reading the Bible and it seems like nothing is coming out of you. So when you've tried everything that you know to do, try singing a song, try worshiping, because I'm telling you that David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. And I'm going to tell you that there is power in praise. There's power in your personal praise. Your personal praise will attract his personal presence. And when you begin to call upon the name of the Lord, I'm telling you that you can encourage yourself through your worship. And I was sitting there in St. Mary's, because you know what I'm going to tell you? This week I've had to literally, really encourage myself. I'm not trying to pity it, but I'm going to tell you, I've sat by the funerals of people. Last week, remember I told you the transparent story of when Jill said, Adam, you know, and I said, they put him on the ventilator. Remember what I said? Oh, no, that's... Guess what? You know, that young man passed this week, 49 years old. And Jill and I are all the way back in the first place that we ministered. And I look at his wife and I was like, there's no words to say. She says, I know. I said, I can't. I mean, I'm speechless because I don't understand what you're going through. And some of you, and I don't understand how my dad can get a miracle, and I don't understand how the mayor can get a miracle, and I don't understand how he chooses and what he does. But I'm going to tell you something, that in the middle of your grief, because that's exactly where David was. David thought that his family had been killed. David thought that, and his family and the mighty men that were with him thought their family had been annihilated and taken from the enemy. But you know what? He had to encourage himself, because there's going to come a point in your life when no one's going to be around you, and the only audience that you have is God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Ghost. And can I tell you, they are ready to move at your beckoning call. They are ready to move in your prayers. They are ready to move in your worship. I'm trying to tell you that you're going to have to encourage yourself sometimes. You're going to have to get to the place where you encourage yourself through your prayers, through the scripture. You're going to have to do it when no one else can do it. Worship team, would you get ready? Because I'm going to tell you, this altar call this morning is going to be a little bit different than it has in the past. Because I believe in the power of worship. And I believe in the power of worship and how it's... I'm going to tell you, some of us are exactly where David was at. And you know what? And I know for two families that are sitting here, two spouses, you are two of the 159. How do you get past that place? How do you get past the place where there's such pain and such grief and there's such questioning? And I remember sitting with Brother and Sister Parker here today, and I remember them calling me a couple of weeks ago, and they said, you know what? It's not... They said they've done all they can do. What do you do? What do you do when the doctor looks at you and says, I can't do anything else? You know what we do? Well, I was sitting on their back porch, remember? And we put on this song by Bethel. And it says, and I know that you can heal cancer. You've healed cancer before. You'll do it again. And you know what? And because you know how we heard it? Because his neighbor was blasting it. His neighbor was blasting it. And I said, oh, that is a powerful song. I said, in light of the circumstances, in light of your daughter Neva being told that there's nothing they can do for the cancer, the leukemia that's in her life, I said, let me pull it up real quick. It's a modern song. It may not be one that you've ever heard of, you know, but let's play it. And can I tell you, the Holy Spirit met us on that, and he encouraged them that morning, did he not? Amen. The Lord encouraged. I'm not trying to speak for them, but I'm going to tell you something. There is power in worship that will move you to the place of getting up from where you're at, from being stuck in the... Do you know the enemy wants to stick you right where you're at? He doesn't want you to think it's going to pass. He wants you to think you're going to stay stuck in that place. And I know in the darkest moments of your life, it will be your song. It'll be a song that comes out of your mouth. It may not make any sense. I'm not going to sing for you. I want to, but I'm not going to sing to you. I want to give you an illustration, but I ain't going to do it. I want the Lord to move. There's a song that's going to come out of your soul. You know that 185 songs are written in this Bible. You know when the first song was written? When the children of Israel, who had been in bondage for over 400 years, in Exodus chapter 15, the Bible says that they began to go and they got to the other side, the waters, they passed through the waters. On dry ground, they passed through the Red Sea. On dry ground, they passed through it. They didn't stay stuck in the place back there. And they got to the other side. And you know what they began to sing? They began to sing a song of worship to the Lord. And do you know what? Miriam had a song. Mary had a song. Zechariah had a song. Why? Because when they began to realize the faithfulness and the power of their God, they could not stay silent anymore. And that's what I'm trying to tell you. I feel the Holy Spirit in this encouragement series trying to tell us it's time to get up. And this morning, he's trying to tell you, don't look for someone else to send you a card. Don't look for someone else to call you. Don't look for somebody to post you on Facebook that they're praying for you. Don't look for anybody else. Encourage yourself, because I put a song in you. I put the scriptures in you. I put my spirit in you, the Lord says. Encourage yourself. Hallelujah. Give him praise. Give him praise. I just want you to know, hallelujah. Yes, go ahead. Let him say it, because we bear one another's burdens here, Brother Parker. We don't. We're gonna get it.
We just received word from Neil that last night Neva's heart rate skyrocketed and the blood pressure dropped, and they fought very hard to keep her out of ICU, which they did. The blood pressure has come up. Everything has come up again, except her heart rate is real high, and it's coming down. I don't know why the devil is fighting so hard, because I know God has healed her.
Yes.
I know that beyond a shadow of a doubt. She's had a visitation from the Lord that says things are going to be better, and I believe that. But she wanted us to request prayer that we could pray for her right now, that the heart rate would come down and it would go back to normal.
Amen. Amen. We're going to pray for that. But I'm going to tell you, can I tell you another story real quick? Lunch is getting prepared. There's a testimony of a song. Jonathan and Melissa Helzer of Bethel Music wrote a powerful declaration over the life of their sons, their friend's son, Jackson. Jackson's kidney and his sister, when I read it, got infected by E. coli virus, and they had to take They had to have blood transfusions and go on dialysis. Because of this, Jackson's parents reached out to their community for prayer and support. A few days before Christmas, Jonathan received a text from their friends, Joel and Janie Taylor, that their son Jackson was in critical condition, and they didn't think the child would make it. Jonathan said, "As soon as I got that text, I felt like this giant of unbelief stood in front of me. I thought Jackson was going to die tonight," he said, we're not going to see a miracle. He said, but in that moment, in the moment of distress, and I say this because of this, but something indescribable happened to the Helzos while they were praying for a miracle. A song suddenly began to come out of their mouths in the middle of prayer. It was prayer that turned into a song, and they started to sing a powerful declaration against the giant that Jackson was facing. In the middle of that unbelief, in the middle of that most devastating moment, a song came out of a prayer. Would you stand with me across this bed? I feel the Holy Spirit beginning to invade the hearts and minds. And right now, Neil, Neva, wherever you're at, whoever's, we're believing. You're standing. We're going to believe. But I'm going to tell you something. Peggy's coming to pray. Amen. I know it. We're led by the Spirit. But I'm going to tell you what Jonathan and what that family saw right then. Do you know what happened? They began to sing this song. Macy's going to sing. You know what I want you to just get ready. In the middle of a prayer, these words started to come out of their heart.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemies. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. So we sing.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar. Is defeated, the King is alive.
I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. Oh, we lift it up to you, Lord.
I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. Raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Fear, you lost your hold on me.
I'm gonna sing.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Is defeated, the King is alive.
So right now, if that song, that prayer that turned into a song, came in the middle of one of the darkest moments of their life, what song are you about to write? What song is about to come out of your life? what song can come out of you? Because there's a song. That song broke the power. You know what happened? Those kids did recover eventually. They did recover. But it was because in the middle of the darkest moment that a power of worship came forth. So the altar call is this. Is there anybody that's going through anything right now? Anybody going through anything that would say, how can I stand where I'm at when God is calling me to move out? So if you've got anything, I want you to let's move. We're going to sing this again. We're not just going to sing it. We're going to declare it. And louder than my unbelief, and louder than that giant of unbelief, as they began to sing that song, as they were encouraged by the words of that song coming forth, the giant of fear began to bow. There's some of you, there are giants that are saying, I'm not leaving you. But I'm going to tell you, there's a song in your life. There's a song that you've got to sing. And the power, the chains of the enemy are going to break. Ha, ha, ha. I feel the Holy Spirit saying they're about to break off the right before your very eyes. Can I tell you, there was a time that I began to see that I was in Irwin, North Carolina, and I remember gripping onto that chain. And I remember seeing when peace like a river. Amen. That song, it is where with my soul. I knew that I was able to walk away from that situation when I began to declare that song, that old hymn. It is where with my soul. I knew right then in that moment, and my hands began to rise. Can I tell you that you're about to get up? You're about to get up. You're about to. There's somebody that's about to get up. There's somebody that's about to walk out of the prison today. There's somebody about to walk out of depression today. There's somebody about to walk out of pain today, because you're not gonna say, hey, I can't do that in front of anybody. You are so desirous of freedom that you're like, no, louder than my unbelief, louder than my pain, I'm gonna raise a hallelujah, because the hallelujah that you've got, nobody can sing your hallelujah. That's what's so powerful about it. Nobody can sing your song. You've got to sing it. And when you begin to declare it, when you begin to sing it, that's when the enemy takes notice. That's when the enemy backs up and says, can't touch it. I can't do anything with it. I've got to let it go. But can I tell you, I'm not trying to do anything. I'm trying to encourage you. You have got to be the one to sing it. You've got to be the one to worship it. And it might not be, I raise a hallelujah. It may be a song that you identify, but I want to ask you, would you move, if there's anybody right now, would you move from where you're at to the front of this sanctuary? Because I believe God is inviting you to a personal encounter with Him right now, like Mayor Brooks had, like I've had, like others have had. I believe right now, like Jonathan Helzer had for Jackson and his sister, I believe right now there are encounters of God that are about to take place. But don't just come to pray. I want you to come to worship. I want you to come and raise up hands, raise up voices, raise up the word, raise it up, raise it up. Let's go, let's worship.
We're gonna sing a little louder, a little louder.
Hallelujah.
Sing a little louder, sing a little louder,
sing a little louder.
I'm just trying to follow the Spirit. He's saying, some of you don't know what to sing. You know what your song is? All you have to do is say this. Hallelujah! That's a song. Some of you don't know what to say. What do I say? What's my song? Your song is hallelujah! Some of you right there where you're at, you just need to raise up hands right there and say hallelujah! Hallelujah! Look at the enemy. The Spirit of the living God is reaching online right now. And He is saying, all I need you to say is hallelujah. And the chains will break right now. The chains of bondage will break. Chains of addiction are going to break right now. Chains are falling in the presence of God as we raise a hallelujah. Are you ready? I feel the Lord do it. He's the only one. Church, He's the only one who can do it. Jobs are being created. Jobs, opportunities are opening right now as we begin to declare hallelujah. Healing's coming. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because you know what? When we're saying hallelujah, we're saying, I don't know how and I don't know when, but I declare I'm still going to win. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You ready? Are you ready? Let's praise Him. God, we're going to give you our hallelujahs louder than unbelief.
Oh, I'm going to sing. I'm going to sing
in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder. You're going to hear my praises roar. Come from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeat.
Ourselves because Philippians 4:13, I can do all things through Christ. Yes. When you say you're too tired, God says, come to me and I'll give you rest. When you say I'm worried and I'm always frustrated, I'm worried, He says, cast all your cares that are on me. When you say I can't go on, He says, my grace is sufficient for you. When we say I can't figure things out, you can encourage yourself because He says, I'll direct your steps. Hallelujah. When he say, I'm not able, he steps in and says, but I am able. When you say, I'm not worth it, God says it will be worth it. When you say, I can't manage, God looks at us and says, I will supply all of your needs. And some of you in the middle of the hallelujahs right now, you're afraid to go back to your seat. You're afraid to go out of these walls, outside of these walls, because of what if it doesn't happen? What? No, 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 no. I'm afraid. What if? But can I tell you to encourage yourself in what the Lord says? I have not given you the spirit of fear. Hallelujah! But I have given you the power of love and of a sound mind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Encourage yourself in your worship. When I was, we're getting ready to close and we're getting ready to go eat. But I was trying to find a song that would fit this moment. I called Jill. I said, Jill, what was that song? When we were in the hotel in North Carolina, burying my grandfather, my mother, and what was that song? She says, Adam, was it this? I'm going to see a victory. I said, I don't think it was this. She comes back. We're hundreds of miles away from each other. She says, I think it was God's going to turn this around. And you know what we did? James, in the middle of that, we tearfully sang that song. You're going to turn it around. You're going to turn it around. You're going to turn it around. God gave me a turnaround. And I thank God. But there's some of you that may not have seen the turnaround in your life. Hear me. I've been with you in the middle of the night. And we didn't see a turnaround. We saw what we thought was the end. But can I declare over to you this morning what the Lord spoke to me in the middle of the day the other day. He said, Adam, I'm going to turn them around. And I'm going to turn them around like I did Mary. And I'm going to show them that I still have the power to get glory out of death. So right where we are, can I pray over you in the name of Jesus? Father, we pray. God, I thank you, Lord, that you have the final say. And I pray right now over everybody under the sound of my voice. God, we pray over the widows, Lord, that don't have their husbands or their wives, Lord. We pray over the parents that don't have children. We pray over the sins of people right now, God. It seems as if the enemy would say, you can't say that, Lord. You can't say that. You can't say that. But I'm here to declare that God is going to give us a turnaround in our faith, that we're going to turn around in our life. We're going to see a turnaround in marriages. We're going to see a turnaround in finances. We're going to see a turnaround, Lord, in our faith today, that God, we're going to be able to walk out of here, and we're going to say, despite the fear, despite the loneliness, despite the darkness, despite, Lord, the fear of being alone and without those people, that God, we declare a hallelujah because you are still here with us. And Father, I pray, would you empower them to sing hallelujah when they don't feel like singing it? Because, Lord, as our mayor said, it has the power to bring life into our bodies. Life, breath into our souls, breath into our faith, breath in the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus, the name of Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. Can we just give the Lord a hand clap of praise right where he's at? Hallelujah. Now you did that because I asked you. Can we give him a praise that is worthy of my life and his life being redeemed? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! So I know. So here's the good news. Dinner's already ready. You ain't got to go anywhere. So if you are going to be a part of us and you're wanting to volunteer, and I pray every single one of you, join me back in the gym, because we're stronger together. We need you all. Get ready. Go pick up your kids. Go wash your hands. Go to the bathroom. We have bathrooms upstairs. If you can make it up there, there's a line. Go wash your hands. Go to the gym. I'm not going to be as long as a sermon in the training, okay? I promise you. God bless you today. Let's go out raising a hallelujah. I'll see you soon.
defeated. The King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder and louder. You're gonna hear my praises roar.